With Straight Smile Solutions, straightsmilesolutions.com, and today we're going to talk about pins and posts in teeth and what happens when you have Invisalign or ClearCorrect or any clear aligner company, any clear aligner product. So this is lightly discussed in the Invisalign and ClearCorrect informed consent, which of course you must have your patient sign before you even deliver any orthodontics. I wouldn't even do it before they even open the contract. You need to make sure that they're on board with this. But in my opinion, the informed consent that's designed by these companies is very nice, you know, and they don't really go very much into detail. So anytime I have something where I'm like extra worried, I'm gonna make sure I discuss it with my patient. And I'm also going to write an additional documentation in the chart, and I might even create my own additional supplemental informed consent form, depending on what I'm seeing. So what makes me nervous is anytime I see pins or posts like this, like this, like this. Obviously these are posts, these are cast posts, there's pins that are screwed in. You guys know what they are. They're not used as often now as they were, you know, way back when, but people have them. Anytime I see a patient with one of these who wants to do ortho, I'm like, hey, that's cool, that's great. But I'm just letting you know, this tooth is a very fragile tooth and it is subject to fracture. No matter if you do orthodontics, you don't do orthodontics. When you do orthodontics, you have a tray that's going to have to come on and off and on and off multiple times a day for possibly a year or two. And that on and off, if the tooth is already a little weak or compromised, listen, that fracture was going to happen, whether it happened today, tomorrow, next month, next year, for this patient. And restorative dentists and prosthodontists know that teeth with pins and posts are subject to fracture. Doesn't matter if you eat on a steak, you bite a bagel, you know. So unfortunately, that fracture is a little bit more likely to happen when you're pulling this thing on and off a zillion times. That was already going to happen anyways, if I'm going to say it. So the problem is that when it happens during Invisalign treatment, the fingers are going to point to you, the treating orthodontist or the dentist who's doing Invisalign, and they're going to blame it on you and the Invisalign. Whereas it really isn't your fault. It was already in poor shape anyways, because it had a pin and a post. It was bound to happen. So I just feel like it's borderline. Are you slightly negligent if you do not specifically discuss it? Borderline, because it isn't in the informed consent. But I would discuss it anyways and make sure your patient knows the plan. What's going to happen if this tooth fractures or if this tooth fractures or this tooth fractures and we have to extract it in the middle of orthodontic treatment? What's the plan? First of all, who's responsible for the cost? Obviously, it's not the dentist, but if you didn't flag it, that's borderline. You know, depending on how they spin it, it might become a real pain in you know what. What are we going to do? How are we going to change the treatment plan? Are we going to put a pontic in the retainer? There's going to be an implant. When will they get the implant? How much is that going to cost? So my suggestion is, just as a CYA, cover your beep, you should definitely discuss it with your patient and document it in chart. And you might even want to create a supplemental form. If you're not sure, you can always ask your your liability insurance company. A lot of times they are on board with all these additional risk management features, and they're great resources, and they may have documents already ready to go. And of course, as always, get your informed consent signed. That is like the responsibility. You don't know how often I work with doctors. Weird things happen like this, right? Like, well, you had the informed consent signed, right? Well, I don't know. You don't know? Even when I was working as an associate orthodontist in a group practice, in a DSO, in an OSO, I never, ever started a case unless it's not my responsibility to make sure the informed consent was signed, but it is my responsibility to make sure it's signed. I won't deliver anything. I won't do anything. I don't care if somebody told me it's signed. I don't care if the office manager told me it's signed. I want to see it in my own eyes. I want to see that it's filed appropriately and that it's done. And I'm going to go to the patient and ask and see if they have any questions, because that's part of my job as the treating doctor, is to make sure they don't have any questions. And anything on the informed consent that I think particularly stands out, like in this case, I'm gonna make sure we have an additional conversation about it, and then I document that. So just some tips and tricks that I've learned along the way. Yes, they can break. All right, thanks so much.